I'd like to present a new paper which performed together with Nikolai Zubarev from Institute of Electrophysics in Ekaterinburg, and I speak about singularity of formation which appears as a result of the Kelvin-Helmholtz stability. This problem is interesting, and I would like to mention here just about Sergei Manakov, because of approximately at the end of May or maybe at the beginning of June, so approximately 2 months before his death, he called me and said, I solved the problem about the integrability for two-dimensional dynamics with the free surface. And unfortunately, his construction contained some mistake. But however, I would like to say that he was very interesting up to the end, the science for which he was an extremely important issue, and therefore it's very important. I want to say that his mistake, first time, was, in some sense, he repeated the mistake of Longhi-Higgins. Longhi-Higgins is well known fluidist from San Diego, and he made the same mistake as Sergei also repeated. But however, it was very non-trivial from the very beginning, at least. Now let me continue my talk about it, my paper. So it's just the plan of my talk, and now I would like to say a few words about some remarks in introduction. So what's it the Kelvin-Helmholtz stability? It's a very well known fact. So if you consider just the wind. Above fluid, so you have a wind somewhere, and then if you perturb somewhere here, then it turns out that here you have the velocity above hump, you have a larger velocity, and therefore the pressure here due to Bernoulli equations will be less. And therefore, you have a tendency to this direction. And if you have a consider hump, then the velocity somewhere here will be less than the mean velocity, and therefore the pressure here will be larger. And therefore, you have such a tendency. And it is just a very simple argument why you have such type of instability. And this instability was discovered by Helmholtz in the 19th century, but they consider, in fact, in the absence of both gravity and capillarity, which demonstrate that the growth rate in such a case will be proportional to k, so it's a linear function. If the gravity and capillarity is present, then gamma has a threshold, and for instance, for waves excited by wind, the threshold velocity is defined by the minimum phase velocity for the gravity Kepler waves without wind, and has an order of 6 meter per second. And so for such type of wind velocity, we have an appearance of like of white caps, and which is observed in the real nature. But I want to tell that the case, so in our paper is Lushnikov in 1995, this phenomenon was connected with wave forks and the appearance of white caps. And so we demonstrated that near threshold we have a existence of such a phenomena which can be connected with wave forks. And we demonstrated that in the loop, in such a case, is satisfied to the rigidity claim that on the question is negative square mass and the irregularity which leads to the collapse. But when the gravity and heterogeneity are absent, the nonlinear stage of this instability is also very interesting. So the first result came in 1979 by Moore, and he demonstrated that nonlinear stage of Hilbert's instability results in formation of singularity of the root cap. It happens in infinite time, it's the most important point. And the surface itself remains smooth, but its curvature becomes singular. And this singularity becomes seeds of for the vortex spiral center. So it's because of, if you consider just one fluid and consider the discontinuity, so in such a case you have a vorticity concentrated on the this line only. And here you can consider the potential flow outside. And then it turns out that the equation governing for such equation is just the Bohr-Rotich equation. And it's only one equation. But for a fluid interface, the motion can be described also by such type of equation, but it's necessary to add one additional equation for vorticity evolution. So when you have an interface between two fluids, the typical situation is excitation of wind by excitation of water waves by wind. In such case, it's necessary to add another equation. And therefore, this situation was investigated numerically, mainly, but there was some theoretical analysis performed by Baker, Kaplish, and Siegel in 1993, and this analysis contained a number of proximities. The main assumption was connected with ignoring of nonlinear interaction between an analytical situation of solution in the upper and lower planes of the case point complex sphere. And this cross term, it's possible to demonstrate, is not small compared to the local one. And therefore, this result, so we want to demonstrate that if you consider the proper choice of variables, then it turns out that gross term disappears in the show. And what else it's necessary to say, if you want, so that in 1993, 1994, we performed together with Spector and Zakharov two papers and demonstrated that the system for interface without velocity, so you have no mean velocity, so you have no Hilbert instability. In such a case, we demonstrated that in very small angle, small slope approximation, analytically we demonstrated that the nonlinear stage or nonlinear dynamics of such system results in formation of the same type of singularities which was found first time by Bain. And important point is the comment that these singularities were consistent with a small slope approximation. And in fact, what I would like to demonstrate here that the Kelvin Hilbert instability, the nonlinear of this instability, leads also to the formation of the same type of singularities. And these singularities later become originate appearance of spiral structures on the interface. So now the equations. Equations are quite simple. So first of all, these are Laplace equations for potential for both fluids. Then I assume that you have two flows at the infinity, V1 and V2 are constant velocity. Then you have two boundary conditions. One is dynamic conditions. It's conditions for pressure, so pressures from P1 and P2 must be equal as in interface. And then you have the dynamical conditions all the interface. So VM here is a normal component, normal derivative of such corresponding potential. So into here is a interface, coordinate of interface.
So gravity and surface tension are ignored.
Yes, is absent. So the system is quite simple. So you have only kinetic energy, nothing more in Hamiltonian, and therefore but here we have instability. So the problem is the problem.
Densities are different.
Yes. Yeah. Different, of course. And what is necessary to do? First of all, it's necessary to introduce another potential, the 1.2. So so that it tends to zero as infinity, and it turns out that this equation which was written before belongs to Hamiltonian. Once it can be written in the usual form, and where psi is a such type of combination, psi 1 and psi 2 is a value boundary value of our potential P1.2. And Hamiltonian in such a case coincide with just kinetic energy. So this miracle solution introduced first time by Zafarov, and here we have some generalization. The most important point is the following, that it's necessary to introduce two boundary values, and then such consider such type of combination. And indeed, such a generalization was introduced, such a Hamiltonian structure was introduced by Kantorovich and independently in our paper with Mitchell Spitzer. Then the next question is about, it's first of all, it's necessary to consider the system center of mass of frame so that you have a such type of condition. If you do it in such a case, it turns out that the growth rate will contain only the imaginary part, which corresponds to instability. You have real part in such a case will be equal to zero. And then you have the regular procedure. It's necessary to expand Hamiltonian in series relative to canonical variables, assuming that the slope is small. It turns out that it's enough in order to investigate the nonlinear stage of such type of instability. In some sense, it's a repetition of what we did together with Zakharov and Spirkin. So if I consider just the H0, so it's a quadratic part, then here it's an integral operator, the modulus Fourier transform is operated just modulus of K, so it's a positive definite operator, and H is a Hilbert transform operator, and from this expression follows immediately the linear Kerr-Newman multistability, omega squared is equal minus C squared K squared, so it's a negative, where C is defined by such a formula. The next point is necessary, the most important point that in this system of coordinates, this instability is a priori. In dimensionless variables, it's possible to rewrite our equation in such a form, it's written here. So I keep only cubic terms with respect to canonical variables at a psi. So you can see that you have a quadratic with respect to psi x, and here you have a quadratic with respect to e. And A standing here is an output number. If, for instance, output number is equal to 1, then it corresponds that you have only one fluid. And if one is not equal to 0, so then the output number is not equal to 0 also. So, in fact, it's a parameter that characterizes our interface. And it is the only parameter. The most important point is the following, that it stands only in Hamiltonian of interaction. A state standing here and A standing here. Okay. Now it's necessary to perform canonical variables. It's necessary to make some simplification of this Hamiltonian. So if I introduce two functions, f and g, and then it turns out that you have a Hamiltonian equation, of course, and Hamiltonian becomes becomes a quadratic. It looks like as follows. So the moon immediately what we can see later that you have one moon. F in fact grows. G is you have a decreasing in time, and therefore there is some possibility to simplify the system. So it's a linear. In linear regime, you have just two separate equations. So you have splitting. So one mode grows in time. So like the growth rate is modulus of k. Another, you have a decreasing k, and therefore this means that for characteristic times you have a such type of inequality, so you can ignore g with respect to f. But it's necessary to keep, nevertheless, this term. If you ignore everywhere, then you have something very, very different. So you have no, so it's necessary to keep both these terms and v, but only linear. Only linear term with respect to it. So it will be the Hamiltonian. The most important point is the following, that if you consider what will happen for equation for f, it turns out that it becomes autonomous. So it doesn't contain any information about it. Concerning the degree mode, you have a such type of equation, that's the most important point. First of all, we can see that this term provides you exponential decreasing, but not only. It turns out that g, roughly speaking, which can be appears due to is quadratic to the respect to f square.
But this is no gravity, right?
No gravity, no capillarity. So it follows immediately that the g is here is order of characteristic angle square. So this means that our equations is valid up to the next order term. So Cartesian of t, which can be considered somewhere here, will be the next order of small parameter which we consider here. The most important point is this equation. This equation can be solved analytically. The trick which we use here, in some sense, is the same what we did together with the Zakharov and Speer. How it's possible to do it? First of all, it's necessary to expand f by two parts, analytical function in the upper half plane and f minus analytical continuation in lower half plane. Then it's necessary to use the usual property for. So p plus minus is a corresponding projectors for analytical functions from any function cell. And then you have a such type of properties, and it turns out that if you consider all combinations which contains in our equation, so look at this one and this one, and if you proceed, then it turns out and we introduce f plus and m minus, and you can see that all these combinations represent the sum of analytical functions of in plus and m minus, plus and minus. And this means that equations for f plus minus are separated in two independent equations. So it's a very interesting point. So if we introduce f plus, if it's equal to f capital, then it turns out you have a such type of equation, and gamma here it's a arcosinus or cosine of a atom number. So all characteristics concerning interface connected with this number of points. This equation can be solved immediately because it turns out that it's an equation. If you differentiate this equation with respect to x and introduce some analog of complex velocity, then you can get the equation of Korb type. And it's a quasi-linear equation, and it can be solved just using the usual method of characteristics. And this solution is written in implicit form, so this means that the velocity is a constant, our velocity, and then you have a such type of, in fact, characteristics.
So x tilde is just has a minimum of Lagrangian choice. And v0 from x it's initial velocity. So now it's necessary, in fact, to analyze this analytical solution. The most important point is the problem that we know that this function CV is analytical function in upper half plane. So this means that all singularities of this function lies in lower half plane. So now the analysis in some sense is very familiar with what we did together with Zakharov and Spector. So what we demonstrated? We demonstrated that if we say have some I don't know pole in low half plane, then it turns out that at t is equal to zero, then it turns out that then you have a appearance of a cut with movable branch points. To find these branch points, it's necessary because the locations are defined by the just such type of condition. So in fact, it looks like as a, I don't know.
Why branch? Why not pole?
Cut. So if you have a pole, then it turns out that instead of pole, you have immediately a time more than zero, then you have a just formation of cut. And then you have a movable branch points.
Okay.
And their position is defined by from such type of equation. So this equation is written here, so it's necessary to solve it. And so what does it mean? This means that if you start from some singularities, these singularities, I mean analytical, begins to move. And some of them can reach real axis. And when the most rapid branch point reaches the real axis, this it corresponds to formation of singularity. And the most important point is the following, that formation of singularity in such a case you have in a funny time. So it's possible to demonstrate. So it is just a simple algebra, some simple in fact the poles. They focus these poles from such type of condition. Next point, probably, I don't know, but however, the most important point is the following. The singularities which appears as a result of movable branch points correspond to appearance of root singularities. Root singularities, very interesting. What kinds of root singularities? And probably, it's somewhere in here. So it's a gradient with respect to x. So it can say so that the x here it's a distance from the point where you have a touching. And delta t here it's time close to the time of columns. So it follows from here that this gradient is proportional to delta t in minus 1/2. So it's a root type of singularities. Moreover, because of
and what is the condition of small t? Is it v naught is smaller than much smaller than unity or not?
Velocity is arbitrary. Which velocity mean?
Mm.
The only assumption is that the angle is small.
Yes,
it turns out that you have the surface remains continuous function, and the gradient eta also it turns out is small. It's possible to demonstrate. And only the second derivative, what?
In what parameter? What is
it's small total? Angle, small angle approximation, nothing more.
So but your problem is defined in terms of the initial velocity.
Yeah,
how is it possible to express this condition?
We assume that our perturbation belongs, of course, belongs to small angle approximation. So if it's wrong, then it turns out that our theory breaks down. So if you assume that you have a very small perturbations with a small angle, so it's a typical situation. If you start from thermal noise.
My question is it correct to keep this V naught together with I? Okay.
So this derivative. This derivative is
No. In front of delta t.
In front of delta t. Here's the thing. So it's some quantity. So it's just a constant. X here it's a point where you have a formation of singularity. Xc. V zero it's initial velocity. And gamma here is a constant. So everything is
okay. Let's postpone.
What? Okay. But it's saying I here, so you have no singularity at all. So when delta x tends to zero and delta t tends to zero, in such a case only you have a singularity. For instance, if delta x is equal to zero, then you have a singularity of such type. Yeah, really, it follows easily. The most important point is the following, that it's necessary, in fact, what the most interesting thing, what we found in our previous paper, the Zakharov and Lemmers paper. We demonstrated that the curvature which is written here, it's a second derivative. It turns out that this guy at the x is small because of up to the formation of singularity, this derivative turns out to be small. So it's possible to demonstrate it analytically because of it corresponds somehow to this derivative. So Vx, it's this velocity, also it's initial velocity. I assume that it's small quantity. And therefore, we see that this derivative at x square is small also. So in some sense, the interfacial curvature at x will be defined by a real part of Vx. I would like to remind that I made this, first of all, canonical transformation. I have a two functions, f and g, and f larger than g. And so, in some sense, eta is proportional to f. I can ignore the decreasing part of connected with g. And therefore, the answer which we obtained, The final answer is here. So you can see it's indeed a singularity standing here because of its real part, and therefore you can see that you have a singularity of this. If the x is equal to zero, then you have a singularity. So it's a typical situation for such type of equation. And at the end of my talk, I would like to say a few words about the problem which we discussed with Sergei also. Unfortunately, up to now, it's an open question. It's an open question whether two-dimensional dynamics with a free surface is integrable or not. From one side, what we demonstrated in our paper, in our papers with Zakharov and Spector, we demonstrated that for small angle approximations, everything can be solved analytically. So you, as a result, you have an equation of Hopf type. So it's for instance for one fluid, or even for interface. It turns out that you have a such type of equation. When the velocity is equal. The most important point is the following, that if you consider it's analytical function somewhere from upper plane, for instance. And then if you introduce, expand the real imaginary plant, then it comes out that you have two couple equations. One equation is just a continuity equation. So M here in such a case plays a role of density and V velocity. And for velocity you have a such type of equation. The most interesting, it's a dynamic type of equations. So V is real here, so it's V is a velocity, N square is a density, but sign here is a plus. This means that you have a negative pressure, and the most interesting thing is the following, that this system of the dynamic type, it's a represent quasi-classical limit for the Quintic-Annales equation. Which is a critical model for the collapse formation. It's interesting. So, in spite of very simple, of course, this equation can be solved. It's not a question. But however, if you consider this system is nothing more as a system for non-linear equation in critical case or for Quintic. Quintic is just a critical for an LS system in one-dimensional situation. It's a one observation. Another observation was done by Hitchin and Zakharov, and they demonstrated that if you have a very sharp gradients of the surface, in such a case the system can be considered as an integrable system. So it's a
Jacobian approximation.
Yeah.
Yes.
High Jacobian approximation, you have Jacobian, then you have an integrable system. So in two limits, in small angle approximation and very high angle approximation, you have an integrable system, and therefore it's natural to assume that the system must be integrable in general situation. So for any angle,
and mean system.
What this? Of course, integrable. But of course, if you take into account the special, it's not. So, if you introduce it, okay, thank you very much.
I finished.
So, questions, Max?
Zhenya?
Yeah?
Did you estimate the inference of the next term? Yes,
we estimated, and it turns out that it makes all the corrections connected with the solar. So the problem concerning G is a quadratic with respect to n, and it's a linear correction, and then it turns out it gives a cubic term for equation log f, and therefore it's small.
Okay.
So let me abandon with representation which I gave on our last Friday. In our simulation, not for this system, when we have only one fluid. Well, as I showed you, unfortunately, from numerics, it looks like high order correction will slow down everything. I mean, it's not clear if that singularity will occur at all or it will occur later times. So I don't know what will happen in this case of Kevin Humboldt. But yeah, I really have doubts that singularity will occur at all.
Okay. So this is comment
should
discuss, but not here, okay. That is possible. Yeah.
Okay, so this is a practical question. We have shear flow instability between two superfluids. There is no viscosity, so it is a real threshold. And this threshold is a Landau type. It's not Kelvin-Hilbert occurs a little bit higher at higher differences. So we observe the formation of what is there. So can you help us to
The important point is the following, that if you consider just the interface or discontinuity, it was demonstrated numerically that nonlinear stage of this instability leads to formation of spirals on
something like that. So because of vorticity concentrates on the line only, and then it turns out that you have a formation of singularity. It's a weak singularity in some sense because of a curvature becomes infinite, but the gradient eta, its small parameter, remains small in spite of. And it turns out that it's a region of appearance of such type of spiral. So instead of you have something like that. And so on.
Yes, but how it gives information? How it gives information of quantum diazomotics?
Why is it wrong? I don't know. Because of it's a classical system. It's a classical.
Nevertheless, there is no big difference. It's actually
No.
Your approximation is actually you are working in terms of a potential velocity. We should check the case of quantum leaping.
Yes, because the formation of vortices.
But it seems to be that the main region of appearance of in such a case of what you mentioned, the main reason of appearance of vortices is just connected with such interfaces. Interfaces somehow become the generator of vortices.
Yes, but
when you take into account damping, I agree with you that its threshold of course different.
Okay, let us shift the discussion to the corridor. Okay,
can I ask you a question with that? So, this simulation which Robert Krasny did in the past, he basically saw this infinite number of spirals. So, we don't need hard gravity for that, basically. This principle produces. I mean, you have to go to high order. Or you think gravity is still.
No, they consider without gravity, without capillarity, etc. So, only such case. Krasny, and not only Krasny, also Moffat and colleagues also, they repeated in some sense. And as I remember, two series of papers from both teams appeared more or less at the same time. And all of them demonstrated the appearance of something like that. So you have another, so it's some periodicity you have. So maybe it's because of the use of periodical boundary conditions on X, I don't know. But however, they demonstrated only such a case. When you have a gravity capillarity, it's a very different situation. Very different. I don't believe that in such a system will be integrable. I believe only that when you have only one fluid, free surface, and in such a case probably the system must be integrable because of in both limits, very high Jacobian approximation, you have a Laplace Gauss equation, NIH, which is integrable, and another limit is just Hopf equation which can be solved by.
Okay, so let us end the speaker again. Let's talk about it.
Нет, можно. Свет.